You can support FPP Radio by shopping online. Whether you're looking for precious metals, bitcoins, or books, you'll find that and more at shop.fppradio.com. Every purchase you make from one of my affiliates, like Namecheap and Amazon, at shop.fppradio.com helps fund FPP Radio. Or you can shop directly from FPP with Bitcoin in the Bitcoin store. That's shop.fppradio.com. Reuters reports the Obama administration said on Monday that it would require drone owners to register their unmanned aircraft as part of an effort to curtail rogue drone flights that pose a danger to commercial aircraft and crowded public venues. Transportation Secretary Anthony Fox announced the creation of a task force of private sector and government representatives to craft recommendations for establishing the first ever federal drone registry. The recommendations are due by November 20th, and administration officials hope to have the registry in place before Christmas, when they say more than 1 million new drones could be given as gifts to new untrained operators. The registration requirements would also apply to drones already in use. Drone industry representatives welcomed the notion of having a mechanism to promote accountability, but questioned whether a new registry could be in place in such a short time frame, and said the government's authority to compel participation remained unclear. Fox said the registration effort would not delay the FAA's goal of publishing rules for commercial drone use by next June. This has been FPP Radio News, online at fppradio.com.
After a flood of customer complaints, Kay Jewelers issued an immediate recall this week of over 2 million cursed engagement and wedding rings. The company's director of public relations released an apology to those afflicted.
I can assure our customers that we were not aware our manufacturers were sourcing diamonds tainted by the Darkling Erla. We're strongly recommending customers who have not yet returned their purchases for a full refund to place a mirror in a bowl of black salt, mold a poppet in your image out of clay and your lover's hair, and then burn the poppet in the mirror before the next full moon.
Industry experts are calling this the most egregious safety oversight in jewelry production since 1973, when Zales disturbed the grave of the 16th century sorcerer Melor.
Sometimes I wake up and I'm trapped in this oil painting of a German village.
They told us that there was a 68% chance that our child would be born with no soul. They sent us this disclaimer suggesting we leave the changeling in the wood and return only at our own peril.
This is the Onion News Network.
Welcome to the Rebel Love Show. We are a once-a-week broadcast from Manchester, New Hampshire, where we are pro-pots, pro-gun, and pro-coffee. You can find all of our contents at rebelloveshow.com. I am Ron Mathias.
And I am the Rebel Mistress.
And today we have a special musical guest here in studio, none other than the one Carlos Mar.
How you doing, boss?
I think you got to give him his whole title. Like, he's Carlos Morales, CPS whistleblower, author of Legally Kidnapped. What else?
Host of the Libertarian Atheist podcast.
Right? Yes, sir.
You're a man of many talents. Many talents.
How is the Libertarian Atheist going these days?
Well, on Podomatic, we're number one in philosophy. We were to check number 15 overall.
Damn.
Yeah, so fucking good.
That's impressive.
Are you still doing it like remotely with...
MK Lords. Yes, I do.
What about
is Calvin jumping on?
Calvin's on occasion, although right now he's in Thailand killing cobras, I'm sure, with kung fu chops. So, you know.
How is he in Thailand?
You know,
I've seen his posts. So.
Well, I see his posts and everything else, and I keep up to date with him because one of the things I kind of told him about was whenever you travel outside the country, it's one thing to go to a place in which people speak English and they're part of the similar culture. It's another thing if they don't even speak English. And one of the biggest things you have to deal with whenever you travel, honestly, especially alone, is, well, frankly, isolation and loneliness. You end up finding out a lot about yourself, but it can honestly be kind of boring after a while. You know, after you see so many temples and everything else, life becomes kind of normalized. And then whenever life becomes normalized without a community, it can become a little bit difficult to kind of adjust. I know he's taking it well. You know, he is a badass. He's one of the most hardcore human beings I've ever met. And as far as in case of the apocalypse, he is the man I'd want to have by my fucking side.
Oh, absolutely.
Side.
He has an article knows how to use.
And
it's a kick-ass.
He knows everything. Like if you're talking about history or anything else, he'll just go off, and it's a fantastic conversation. So, and it's just a loyal dude. So, yeah, I know Calvin. Calvin will probably be listening to this as well, and I hope the best for him on that end. But right now, I'm pretty much been doing shows with MK Lords recently, though.
So is she atheist?
Yeah. Yeah. And so I think there's a new episode that I'm going to be releasing with Grove Banan of School Sex Podcast. And we actually taped that at... can you turn down my headphones just a little bit? Is there any way we can do that?
Yeah.
It's really loud on here.
All right, there you go.
Okay. God, that's so much better. Right. So right after we got back from New York City from the Liberty Fest NYC, we ended up stumbling into Richard Grove's home. I don't know if you know Richard. He's from... Wow, I'm blanking out right now. Just Google Richard Grove.
What was Liberty Fest? Because I wanted to ask you about that, actually.
So Liberty Fest was an interesting event. There was okay showing as far as the amount of people that came out. MK spoke regarding the nature of, you know, destructive subcultures within any single kind of group. So essentially, whether it's a Liberty group, an atheist group, or anything else, you can end up developing a cult of personality, and it's important to recognize that whenever you see it coming. Just because individuals agree with you on specific principles doesn't mean that they're going to have necessarily a lot of integrity. And just because people agree with certain principles like being anti-authority doesn't mean they're actually anti-obedience whenever it comes to listening to people who are more intelligent than them and kind of falling for their bullshit. My speech was in regards to, of course, Child Protective Services. I did talk about that, but I used that as a kind of launching point to talk about a bigger philosophical concept, which is the idea of sphere of influence and sphere of control, which is essentially the moment you start dedicating your life to that which is outside of your control, you inevitably suffer. And that's a problem that libertarians, especially in the political realm, can end up falling into, where we put all of our faith in someone like Ron Paul getting elected. At the moment that he's not, we feel depressed and insignificant. And if we are spending all our time trying to end things like the Fed when we're not actually... that's actually within our control, and then not paying attention to things within our own life, like our family life, our love lives, our friendships, and everything else, we're going to live a pretty meaningless life.
Well, you have a good in your life with activists and, you know, being happy and doing living your life. You can't do this 100% of the time. You have to do other things. You have to, like, for example, you're playing guitar. You're you're really into music. You know, everyone has to have a pastime, a hobby, something else that's not just Liberty.
Yeah. So that brings me to the question. Like, I know you spoke at Liberty Fest, MK Lords, and probably Jeffrey Tucker and everyone else. But how is the social aspect of Liberty Fest, like, in comparison to?
I like New Hampshire more. I mean, honestly, I like Liberty Forum more. I like Porkfest more. Honestly, New York in the first place. I just actually don't really like Brooklyn. The amount of human beings around me, the little amount of nature that I can actually get out to, can be kind of claustrophobic. Okay. And it's just not... I know when I was like 22, when I was out drinking and partying and everything else more often, that would have been more fitting for me. But now, a little bit later on, it can just be a bit too chaotic. And I think it's almost kind of toxic for people to be that close quarters. Because, you know, a lot of the value that we have for things, you know, comes from scarcity. That's price and everything else. But I also think that's with humans as well. So if we are being inundated with all these people around us, they become pests, not, you know, people that we try to know. So the more we're kind of clustered together, especially within a vast amount of cultures altogether. I mean, there's benefits to multiculturalism. And there's also some negatives where you just don't know really who to trust. That just becomes really chaotic for me personally and neurologically. So I wasn't honestly that big a fan. I met some interesting people, though, when I was out there. Some people who wanted to deal with Child Protective Services and everything else. But overall, I'm kind of done with New York. And the event as a whole, though, I was glad to speak. Some of the people that they were promoting, the main speakers like Gary Johnson, I could give a fuck about a loser who's going to lose a third time in a row. He's running again.
Why?
Oh, because he loves the attention. Yeah. That's why. Why do politicians run all the time, especially ones who know they're going to lose? Who don't pay their... You realize Johnson's actually been sued to get paid by his workers, that he's calling fiscal responsibility by the United States government? That's... believable, is it?
He was a keynote, or
yeah, and no one was watching the speech. It was hilarious. There was like pictures, and like it was just really funny to me. And then another speaker that they had, another keynote, was Austin Peterson,
who's really
also running for LP. And again, people weren't watching his speech. I believe. I mean, Brett kind of told me, he was saying like, I want you to be part of my army. It's like, Austin, you have the charisma of an AIDS-infested tampon. I don't really want to hear you right now. And it was just one of those things where I was not exactly overwhelmed by
everything. I'm really glad you told me that, because I was
of
Liberfest, like, come. And he wrote me, like, come, register. And I'm like, I hope, like, he made it seem like it was going to be huge, and I kind of felt bad for missing it, but now I'm like, whatever I was doing was the
best. Well, no, I mean, if you compare it to Liberty Forum, Liberty Forum is a hell of a lot better. Liberty Forum, by the way, for everyone, it's going to be in February. I'm not even sure if I'm going to make it out this year, but I will still advertise for it for free, because it is a great event. It was the first event I ever joined with the Free State Project. I was invited while I was still living in North Carolina, and, you know, I flew, got to give a good speech, meant way more people than you would at Liberty Fest NYC, and it was just a wonderful event to meet a bunch of like-minded individuals for not very much money. And then, of course, the Mecca, as we've discussed many a times, Porkfest, the greatest conference of all time. Oh, but it's not really a conference, far. It's a festival. And so, yeah.
You're skipping convention here. You went to that last year.
Mm-hmm.
Did you enjoy that one or no? Nothing.
I didn't really go to it. I just went to the party.
Reason to go is Halloween party.
Yeah.
Yeah. It's the best part of it.
Yeah, I had to cancel on that. I do apologize for anyone who's going to come out for that. I ended up having other plans, getting flown out to San Diego to deal with a case out there. So,
do your job sometimes, you know. Money's at.
You got to go where the money's
activism.
At.
You got to, you know, work your skills before you be an activist.
Yeah. So I'm excited to go out in San Diego and kind of find that out. APS case out there. So, well, I'm sure we'll be back soon, right?
Oh yeah, we'll be back, and you'll be playing some music when we return.
He'll play us in, guys.
We've all had enough of that jingle, don't you? If you're going to invest in property in New Hampshire, it just makes sense to support a Liberty-friendly realtor. Call Mark Porcupine Real Estate for investment property or rentals in the Free State, or visit his website. Come on, you know it. Oh,
yeah. Something sexy. How sexy. Live during the breaks, FYI. Web keys. Yeah, web keys. I know who you are.
Yes, we do.
How much time we got?
You got like 2 minutes. 3 minutes. Something like that.
Wait, I got the clock.
Yeah, show the clock.
Could you do me the biggest favor ever since I got grab me a beer by chance?
Every once in a while, I get information that's worth changing. It's pumpkin, though.
It's cider, not beer.
Yeah, it's cider.
Wait, do we have beer? Like, actual beer?
I have liquor right here if you want this. That's all, is that or vodka or beer? Like, we're low-key this time. Or pot if you want to smoke.
Oh my god, that's fucking delicious.
I know.
I don't even like pumpkin things.
See, I love that.
I actually don't like that. I love and shit, and I think it's too sweet. It's too sweet. I stopped drinking that. That's why it's still left over.
I've only eaten 300 calories today. I bet you
everything's gonna taste delicious.
Everything's gonna taste delicious right now. I bet you any other time I'd be like, this is disgusting, but right now, sweet calories.
What the fuck is that?
That is the LRN show clock.
Well,
I frame my I'm not gonna we'll be back in like 3 minutes.
Yeah, I'm also not gonna play for the whole thing.
No, yeah.
That's what I'm gonna do, like a little slow, sexy thing that gets us right back in.
Yeah, that's fine. That works. You're gonna make a pork fest though, right? You have to.
I will not miss one of those for at least the next couple of years.
Oh, me either.
Unless I pop out kids or some
you're gonna,
shit.
You're gonna come to our wedding, right? You got to.
You can get what pay me.
Pay to go to our fucking wedding.
Well, yeah, we'll be at Porkfest this year.
If you're fasting or something. Their money, you're perpetuating
the killing. Yeah, there's actually a decent amount of people in the chat today.
Oh. Okay, so ask the question again.
Is Carlos fasting or something?
Yeah, so when I went to New York, I ate nothing but whiskey and pizza, and so I gained a little bit of weight. So I started noticing that I was having slight hormonal issues, so I'm just lowering my calorie amount for a little bit of time over the next couple.
Welcome back to the Rebel Love Show, and we have Carlos Morales here live in studio. And if you're listening to LRN.FM right now, go jump on a computer or on your smartphone, go to rebellovshow.com, click on live, and you can watch the live stream of Carlos here playing guitar here in
and
the studio.
Chat with us. We'll answer your questions.
If you go onto the site, you can see the chat there live right on the page. You can interact with us, and we are answering questions from the audience. So if you have any questions for Carlos or us, hit us up in the chat and we'll bring it up on the show.
Take it away, Carlos.
Hello again.
Beautiful. Beautiful.
A
all right. So, Carlos, you were going on a rampage when you walked in about the Democrat presidential debates.
Well, you know, it's interesting because if fall of, you know, the collapse of Rome, if people were able to actually witness it occurring right in front of their face, in the same way that I was able to witness the fall of Western values as a whole when I watched the Democratic debate.
Yeah.
When you hear a man like Bernie Sanders say that the entire reason why you're not succeeding is due to those who have already succeeded by blaming the rich every single time you can, by stating things like the 1%, which, by the way, you are within the 1% of the world if you make more than, I believe, $30,000 a year. So it's just a ridiculous statement, right? By just making that 1%. Now, what he brings up, and I have such an issue with, is the culture of victimization, right? Where everyone gets to say how important it is to bring up how they're being victimized on a constant basis. And what this breeds is a need for the state, because it is other people exploiting them with their free market, Vegas, what is the word, casino capitalism practices that has led to the downfall of the middle class. It's a lie that it continues to perpetuate. It's not the money that's the problem, right? It's not the economic reasons. You know, the fact that if we went with Bernie's plans, it would cost $15 trillion, I believe, over the course of 10 years. It's not that. It's the culture around it. It's people whining, even though with all the regulations within the United States right now, you can still succeed in life. You can still do things. But with him, he's making it sound as if you cannot. And the only way for us to succeed, to not fall, is by subsidizing public education, i.e. college, as you're saying, by regulating all of the markets, by stating that freedom is a vice, that it leads to disaster, even though every single thing he's stating is not true. It just kind of blew my mind. And then he could kind of see Hillary Clinton jumping on the bandwagon. And what was really sick was Bernie, halfway in between, had to make sure to tell everyone, I'm not a pacifist. I'm not a pacifist. I think we should use war when we need to.
Well, he said that in the debate.
Yeah, he said
use war when we need to.
That is definitely not a quote from him, but I do. Stating that he simply was not a pacifist, that he believed that we should have to go to Afghanistan when Osama bin Laden terrorized us, as he put it. And it was an affront to everything that has built up the little amount of freedom that we still have left within the Western world. And the fact that he even brought up things like Denmark's socialist practices as being beneficial, when in fact Denmark is trying incredibly hard to get out of the socialist principles that is right now breaking apart their economy, in part because of the influx of immigration. That's a complete side note. But the only person that I saw there who actually liked even for a second was the guy who just dropped out today, Jim Wood. You know, he stated that affirmative action is racist, which it is. He also stated, whenever he was asked about the NRA, and this was a really disgusting thing, at the end of the debate, everyone was saying, well, I have a D- of the NRA.
As if that's a great thing.
As if it's a positive thing.
Yeah.
But Jim, he stated, you know, they're like, well, you have an A. And he goes, well, you know, a lot of people here, these politicians, they have bodyguards with 24/7 with guns. America was founded on the idea that you should be able to protect your family, protect your wife, protect your kids, protect yourself. And it'd be hypocritical for us to go against weapons when we're using weapons to protect ourselves. It's like a libertarian just showed up by accident. He's like, hey, I have some logic for you guys. Ron Paul just showed up.
Oh, my God. Democrat saying this on stage in a debate.
Yeah. And if you look at his side note stuff, he even said that we should legalize drugs and make them the same as cigarettes. A Democrat. And he just dropped out because, of course.
Well, that's what happens. No Liberty candidate's ever going to win any presidential election.
I don't even know how you guys sat through it.
It's like I was drunk.
Trying to be sold a timeshare. So.
Money, power, and respect are all yours at Credit
LRN.FM.
Yep.
Learn.fm, we're on IPM Nation, and then CoreShowBlogShow.com.
Megan's driving in California right now, so she's one of the links.
Oh, yeah, just LRN.
She's driving with Tim from Robertson Roberts.
Oh, cool.
Yeah, she's working for us, so he's helping out with the road trip.
Yeah, just LRN. First time, so you get approved. Get up to $100,000 in instant business credit. Many people will get cash on the spot. Use those two tools in your new corporate credit engine so you can walk into the bank and get your project funded.
I turn it on the tuner whenever I'm not. Oh, that's right. We have our fun folks. Yeah. People asking questions?
He just said, damn, this segment was liquor, guitar serenade, and the bitter destruction of our very society.
Hey, that's me. That is that segment covers thing about my personality. All we gotta do is to like weight loss right afterwards and we're set.
Have you seen James Cleveland? Have you seen how much?
Yeah.
No,
I'm impressed with him. He's lost like 100 pounds.
Good for him, man.
So did time. That was old. That was old. Zolzko, but also Daryl.
Yeah, Daryl.
That's who. Yeah. I'm happy to see more and more Liberty people losing weight.
Hashtag I've gained too much 420 weight. Blaze it YOLO swag. That was
so many words there. I hated 420 YOLO swag. All the words.
That was like James Cleveland's like campaign.
Yeah, that was his campaign slogan.
I know. That was my introduction to James Cleveland. I was like, I do not like this guy.
Aww.
And then I heard him on Peek in the Gang, and I really liked him.
He's so sweet.
Yeah.
His
I'm incredibly judgmental. I don't know if you fucking discovered this yet. But I do not have a lot of patience.
His actual keynote speech at last year's convention was like heartwarming.
That's awesome.
Because he really talked about like why he does activism and shit like that, and it was he had.
Did he come out as gay?
James Cleveland?
Yeah.
I don't think so.
There was someone else who came out as gay in the Keen community who was living with Chris Cantwell. Ask chat. Answer that question. Trivia question? Who was living with Chris Cantwell and came out as a homosexual? In my radio voice.
Well, no, his convention thing was actually
I want my dog to
amazing. There's standing ovation, people crying in the audience. Like, it was intense.
Dude, it's always good when you make people cry.
Yeah.
That's my life motto.
Because he didn't see it coming from him, too. You know?
That's not my life motto, people listening. That is not my fucking life motto. You know, we could come in with me playing a little bit low and you saying shit.
Yeah, I'm down for that. Let's do that.
No, he just says his introduction. I'm gonna play, you know, a little bluesy. This is how I always wanted to do podcasts. Whenever I had to do shitty Google Hangout podcasts, like that, I knew 20 people listened to.
Welcome back to the Rebel Love Show. We have here in the studio the musical talented artist known as Carlos Morales. And besides being a CPS whistleblower, he also is a aficionado on all things atheism and against the states in his great podcast, the Libertarian Atheist Podcast.
I guess for an atheist, I would expect you to have like more emo-tastic songs. But it's just, you know, they're all like happy and so full of bit disappointed. What happened to all the emo stuff? Like, we need a, like, emo album. You know, sometimes you just have
to... if you need Morales emo album.
Oh, okay. To be fair, if you need emo or sad stuff, you can read my book, Legally Kidnapped, The Case Against Child Protective Services. I have enough sadness in my life from the hundreds of emails I get a day from people dealing with child protective state as a whole that my other outlets can't also be emo. You know, I need like positivity. I need occasional MDMA. I need some positive things to come in my life.
Fair enough.
And I feel music is one of those. Now, when it comes to music, I feel as if, you know, I use a looper pedal, right? I have a very specific kind of weird music that I do. I used to play for punk bands and different stuff. And I sung like emo shit, you know, about like break, fuck the state, everything else. And whenever it was fuck the state, it wasn't fuck the state, empowerment. It was like fuck the state and they kill people. So, for my music though, I try to create kind of a story every single time I play. You know, you have your climax, you have the bring up, you have everything kind of in there. Now, some of them are going to be kind of in minors or majors or whatever else, and some of them are going to be more sad, but I always want them to be kind of epic. And that's kind of how I feel I want everything to be, is, you know, life's about collecting stories and trying to leave it better than when you got here. And I almost feel that way about, like, music. I want to create a story, and I want you to feel better or at least more passionate when I'm done with it.
Are there any real-world life experiences that you have an inspiration for your music?
I mean, all the fucking CDs that were worth listening to that kind of the forefront of where I'm at right now. I mean, you know, I started playing guitar when I was about 8 years old because I wanted to be Kurt Cobain. You know, like I listened to Nirvana and I was like, this is the sexiest thing I've ever heard. And I'm sure there was something slightly sexual as to my obsession with Kurt Cobain. Like I'd write like Nirvana and everything else. And in my mind, and I was a very emo kid. Yeah, I think about the fact that I was so analytical at the age of 7 years old. And I was really religious too, because I would always think about how am I going to burn in hell? And I would try to figure out like logical deductions of exactly which things to do to not burn and everything else, which is part of why I have such a passion against religion, because I can think about the OCD and the inner turmoil it cost me as a kid. But also, I had a lot of kind of pure negligence when I was younger. It was, I didn't get along with people very often, and there's this constant want for me to shut up the back of my head, the part that was so self-hating, just so I could talk, be so awkward. And so I found music as this great way to kind of detach from that, because I didn't really like my family situation. I mean, I have okay parents, but it was kind of a rough spot because I was one of, you know, five kids. And my older brother was this, you know, great basketball player. He did everything well in sports, and I was this lanky tall kid who couldn't control his body. But the one thing I could do was go home and play guitar for 5 hours. And the way I played was, I didn't go play with friends. I would always compare myself to Eric Clapton or Carlos Santana or Jimi Hendrix, even at the age of like 8 and 9. And because of that, I became very logical about my type of playing, trying to figure out every single little niche. I kind of did it mathematically to break down everything, even though I really didn't even have any lessons. And I ended up being able to play really well as a result from there. And it was just this great outlet that I always knew I could go back to that. No matter how bad my day was or anything else, I could always go play a, you know, fucking guitar solo, relearn another Jimi Hendrix song or do something else. And I swear, if it wasn't for music, I don't know how I would have made it through a lot of those. I mean, I guess I could have just played video games the entire time, like so many other youthful folks. But this was one of those things where it was a really great intellectual endeavor and just a personal endeavor to deal with that inner frustration that I was having.
I definitely get that.
No, I see that. I mean, I wish I actually had that as a child. I mean, I'm one that where like, TV put in front of you. There was a video game put in front of you.
And
I got out of that. Like,
yeah,
that,
I played. That, I played plenty of video games too. Like my only, had one friend, one like you know solid friend from like 7 to 18. You know, this other kid that we do athletic stuff like backyard wrestling and shit like that. Stupid white trash stuff. He was my white trash friend, and everyone needs a white trash friend when you're growing up. By the way, if you don't have one yet and you're younger than 18, find one. They're shit tons of fun. Although you may go to jail at some point. Now. But I had a friend, though, who, you know, he had Asperger's, and which is why I believe I've become so accustomed to the libertarian community.
Yeah, that makes sense. Yeah, most of us are near that. Or
actually found out about atheism and libertarianism at the same time. Like, as in, like, work He was kind of the kid I always relate to, even though he was aspie as fuck. He was really mean and a bunch of issues, but he was just kind of tough because he was the only one who kind of understood me. And our way of kind of bonding, though, was playing a lot of video games. I mean, I up until I was like 20, I did Street Fighter 2 tournaments. Like,
well,
I still
Rob loves video games too. Is that
was, well, your... I when I was a kid and whatnot, yeah. But I'm saying, like, for me,
it was,
yeah, because like my thing when I was a kid,
you little spoiled brat.
Oh, I know your childhood is so much, you know, more depressing. I guess you can say like mine's is a dream compared to what yours was. I know I can't really bitch about my childhood compared to what yours was like.
Well, I mean, I had an escape too. I think my escape was just reading. Like, I really felt like I could like just go away and be in a different place, even though I can physically be in a different place. And I mean, that really paid off because it made me smarter than anyone else and more, you know, just wanting to inquire.
Well, you were smart enough to get the hell out of there.
Yeah.
You know, you made it through and you're like, fuck this. I'm going somewhere completely different.
Yeah.
Yep. We all have our outlets.
Yeah, I know. Yeah, yeah. But my outlet, it was nothing. It was like, it was just gaming and stuff like that and chilling. Oh, like hanging out with friends and that, playing games and or... when I was younger, it was we did do football, but it was all sports. Like everything was either sports or video games. Like everyone I knew.
Well, know? I mean, and the sports thing was I was always trying to be good at sports because my older brother was a fantastic athlete, and it wasn't until I found boxing when I was around 12 that I finally figured out something that I was actually good at.
So you lost a bunch of weight, right? Mm-hmm. Were you fat? Were you a fat kid?
No, I wasn't really fat till I was 16. Oh. I got stuck on specific prescription drugs and other prescription drugs were taken out. Long story. I'm not going to go into all of that. But yeah, I got up to like 320 by the time I was 18. And so like on prom night, for instance, I was playing Halo 2. Like there was no social. And I was also pretty stupid. And I will state that because mine, I couldn't quite think. And it was because I wasn't popped on shit tons of prescription drugs. You know, Depakote, Zyprexa, Adderall,
why,
all these
why
things.
Were you put on all those?
When I was 7... for me to pay attention in school because I would, you know, I would look at a teacher and I wouldn't even be listening because I was so bored. And so therefore ADHD. And so then they stuck me on Ritalin. And then I started having frustration issues around the age of 12. I was a pretty frustrated kid, but I also had siblings and just hated school as that. A few fights. I think I remember when I was 12, this is the way they figured out I was bipolar. Kid who I'd always been getting in, you know, like kerfuffles with, because I was imagine this for a second, 6'2", 170-pound, 12-year-old. I scared the fuck out of people's parents, because they'd be tackling the hell out of their 5'4" kids. But this guy called me a dirty Mexican, and snapped. I grabbed him by his, and I was the thing is, I was playing football, and then I'd go box. So I had a lot of frustration going on, and I grabbed him by his helmet and started bashing his fucking helmet in. And they just looked at me, they're like, you need to, like, my coach wasn't going to grab me because I was bigger than him. So he's like, just get the hell out of here. My parents said, oh, well, you have bipolar, or a psychiatrist said I have bipolar disorder, got stuck on drugs, and, you know, it kind of came from there.
Wow.
Damn. All right. Well, you'll be cheering us up a little when we get back.
Yes, ma'am. I got rid of my y'alls. No, I didn't get rid of my y'alls. I got rid of my southern accent.
How'd you do that? Just practice.
I overcompensated with my voice, and then suddenly it started changing. Although I still say y'all and howdy. But everyone becomes more comfy whenever you say howdy. Like,
you think so?
Fuck yeah.
I say howdy, just relaxes everyone.
Hey, howdy, everyone. This is Carlos Morales, the Libertarian Atheist Podcast. You know, it's kind of like warm and nice.
Howdy. Wow. That's so country.
Yeah, but I people say like it's country, but then they look at me and they're like, oh, fuck it. He's going to do what the hell he wants to do. He's multiculturalism, in essence. Jew, black, and Spanish.
I was always quiet, Webkeys.
Can I get another drag everyone. Off that ridiculous
it's
mod?
Horrible.
Oh, yeah, yeah, man.
That's fucking delicious. This is
a sick mod.
Holy shit. Alcohol really affected me. This is really high alcohol. What's
yeah,
up?
I got Jesus I got really tipsy off of it.
It's 14 proof.
See, I can't do the pumpkin cider on that. I don't know. I did not like it at all. I'm not much of a cider
so this,
person.
This is how much?
That was $85
Oh my God. How much are the atomizers? Or is it you got to replace it yourself?
You got to replace it yourself. But, I mean, you can get those for, like, what, $5 or something like that?
Yeah. I'll buy one of these.
I saw you got a new mod. What are you vaping on?
This is...
It's a cool-looking mod.
This is fucking blueberry yogurt.
Oh.
Nice.
But I need to add in... I have the thing in my house. I have this one, so it adds in more air.
Okay.
So it's a replaceable. So I can actually do the whole thing myself. And so you can put it at higher voltage, because right now I can only do it at like 2.5.
Okay.
Which is kind of gay.
Yeah, that's a little low.
Compared to this shit. Jesus! So what was it? Was it?
The story of your 20th birthday?
Yeah, you're kind of talking about that.
Wait, who's asking gonna, this?
No, we have show notes. I've thrown those stuff in.
Oh, we
there.
Don't need to talk about that. I think I've talked enough about my personal life. I'll switch to something else.
Yeah, yeah.
I'll put this on my RSS feed afterwards. When is okay. When does this drop? When does this drop, motherfucker?
Whatever.
The
album drops like right after.
I'll have it uploaded sometime this week.
Do you want to talk about...
Wait, am I playing music next?
Yeah. Nah, I don't care. It doesn't matter. You don't have to.
Yeah.
Yeah,
we can go into
you.
Something else.
I'll play some music.
Yeah. You didn't play last segment.
Yeah, I'll do some Spanish shit. It'll be fun.
So you can play, and then we can talk about Ian Schiff.
Erwin. Sometimes it amazes me the stuff that she...
I fucking cried.
Yeah.
I sat there, and I fucking cried. Kostrick was actually at his hearing. Like, he was there for the shit.
I always forget how old school Kostrick is.
Kostrick is a man. I love that man.
There's so many stories.
I respect
from, you know,
him so fucking... Like, there's not a lot of men in this community. What I mean is, like, the classical definition of American man. Honestly, we don't have any of those anymore. We have pussies.
This is the Liberty Radio Network. Broadcasting the latest liberty-oriented audio content 24 hours a day at LRN.fm.
Welcome back to the Love Show. We got Carlos here to take us out with some Spanish love.
Thank you.
So that's going to lead right into what happened earlier this month. Sad news. Hero of mine as well, Erwin Schiff, the man has stood up to the federal government and paid a heavy, heavy price for it, refusing to have the federal government steal from him for tax evasion. So he refused to pay taxes, went to jail 3 times for it. He passed away while in custody behind jail cell, all because he refused to allow the federal government to take what is not theirs.
And you know, there was a question that was asked, which they just simply let him go for a second because they knew he was going to die, right? Like Peter was fighting why he didn't die with his family. And that is such an easy question to answer when you know the nature of the state. It was a political move. They did it on purpose. They wanted to show you what you do when you don't pay up.
Yeah. We think it's so horrible. We're like, how could they?
It's objectively horrible.
Yes, it's horrible. But the state, they're thugs. They're trying to send you a message, and their messages will kill you.
Well, it's gangsta as fuck.
It's not something that a lot of people, you know whenever someone advocates, like, we just need more taxes, we need to do this. Like, no one ever actually thinks about the consequences thereof. Like, if you really think that someone should be in jail for tax evasion, not paying their taxes, are you going to hold that person in their jail cell while they're dying, so they can't see their family? Are you actually going to be the one personally to do that? You know, I always try to do a thought experiment with anyone that, whatever they're advocating, like, go to the logical conclusion, the end of whatever that policy or whatever it is they're advocating for that the government should do. All right. So if you think that people should be kidnapped and thrown in a cage because they didn't pay the people that you support, are you willing to actually carry that out yourself?
There's this term used. It's called absurdum. And it's whenever you reduce something to its logical consistency, the term absurdum generally. Thinking this is like kind of absurd thing, but in this particular case we have pretty good evidence this is actually what happens, and people will still justify it. They'll still just say, well, this is one thing that occurred and maybe it wasn't done right, but we still need the state. And when I see that, I just, it makes me kind of crawl. It just saddens me inside. It's kind of like whenever I bring up, you know, 405,000 kids or 410,000 kids, you know, in child protective services custody right now. And when I bring up numbers, statistics, and everything else, I used to say, like, I felt guilty for it, for being investigated. I don't feel guilty anymore because I've done way more by everything I do now than I could have ever done bad when I worked for them. But what brings me down and saddens me on this constant basis is the justifications that people will do. And that is kind of like what we were talking about earlier with the fall of Western values, that kind of victimization, that kind of appeal for daddy. And it's not quite a shocker whenever you think about the fact that the state has set us up in such a way through public education, the welfare state, to destroy the merits of parenting and the family by replacing our fathers with teachers, public school indoctrination teachers, right? And by replacing the work of our fathers or of our mothers and that nuclear family work ethic with money from the state, money stolen from others. And then the more the state does, the more activities it takes over, the more people seem to forget that those activities ever existed before the state. People never took care of the poor before welfare. People never Social Security.
They're born into this system. This is generational. That stuff that we're talking about, that stuff, you know, like the Social Security and all that jazz, Medicare, we're generations deep into that being in place. Like, that's what people, most people alive today know from birth, that is the case, that, you know, the IRS exists, that taxation exists, that war exists, that the police state exists. They're not seeing it happen, to start up in front of them. They're born into that. They know that from birth now.
Yeah, we're born actually the tiger who's born in the zoo, right?
Yeah.
So we're born in the zoo, we're born in the state of confinement, and then we say every single thing that occurs within the confinement is human nature, right? That's just the way it is. Humans immediately do things like nuclear war and throw people in cages for the wrong plants because that's just the way it is. That's human nature. And when you're born, you know, that's kind of the cave idea. Or if you just think about a kid who's born in a garage. Just say the I believe there's either a book or a movie about this. I think it's called The Room, not the shitty one. But a baby who was born in a garage to a mother who was raped by someone who's repeatedly keeping them into that garage. And that's the only place the kid knows. That's the only idea the kid knows. And so everything is based off of that idea, off that state of confinement. And that's the society we live in, where we can justify the most obscene of actions because that's simply the way it is. And anyone who tries to step out of that is called an ideologue, right? Which I consider myself an ideologue, radical. And I am radical. Even when I say in my book, this is a book because it goes to the truth. It doesn't go to trying to appease others. I'm not asking for a form of asking for abolition. And all of those statements are considered ridiculous. But even if we never end the state, do you want to leave this world begging your slave masters for reform? Or do you want to leave this world as a fucking man?
Now, me and Anne had a conversation actually yesterday about it where, I mean, a joking like amongst other liberty folks, like, you know, who's the Fed? Are they ever going to bust us for just being talking free, like having free speech? You know, at the end of the day, the state's going to state, you know, they're going to go after you if they really want to. And at the end of the day, do you want to go away quietly? Should we disappear? Like, you know, bug out? Because, you know, people do that. You know, people come down to this far down the rabbit hole. They see that, like, it's futile, or they see the writing on the wall and they want to live a little bit longer.
I mean,
and they just want to disappear.
We're on a different level of kind of just thinking and it's existing at this point. We're living life with a purpose. And not just like, oh, we're going to go to work tomorrow and put on our clothes. Like, that's just, you know, what we have to do to survive. But we're here trying to live as free as possible. And if someone were going to try to bring the hammer down, like, do you just, like, surrender?
Like, no.
It just depends. Like, we say no, but when we get pulled over for a traffic ticket, we do, right? So it's a matter of, that's when the matter of personal morality versus ethics comes in. So I did this thing where it was, how much more time do we have, by the way?
None.
We're going to discuss my article, when is it okay to kill a Child Protective Service investigator, after this break.
Time began, tyrants have taken aim at personal liberties. Now there's a movie that aims back.
The government has no more right to tell us what to put in our bodies than they have to take our guns or tell us what books we can read.
Six drug police were eaten by bears while raiding a marijuana farm.
Now the mic's on.
Hi, Holly Bean Seal. Thank you for posting about us on the internets. I'm not sure who you are, but if you want to expose yourself to the world, either do it through the chat or you can send me a private message if you have any questions or anything you'd like to talk about.
You do have a question from the chat.
I do have a question.
Yeah, so in the chat...
In the chat.
Let me see here. Kickstart wants to know, if you know you're about to die, what's the last song you'd want to play before you go?
Oh. Well, not the last song I'd want to play, but the last thing I'd want to hear. Castles Made of Sand by Jimi Hendrix.
Choice.
Fuck, Jimi Hendrix is completely not rated. He's rated. Everything he played was perfect. Like, I play some of his songs, and then I think afterwards, how is that even possible? Like, that he wrote that. And what's even sicker is, how did he sing so sexy, so seductively, while he was doing it at the same time and on acid?
Do you think Jimi Hendrix would be revered as much as he is if he hadn't died? If he, like, lived for, like, another 40 years and put out, like, 10 more albums?
Impossible to say, right? Like, Eric Clapton did live that much longer and was still revered. And Jimi actually was switching to more jazz-type thing at the end there. What I would have loved to have seen is more work from Zappa with Jimi Hendrix. Because Frank Zappa is one of my favorite musicians of all time. I mean, really just beautiful ensembles that he would create. And I think more of Jimmy as the performer than Frank. I mean, if you just listen to Peaches and Regalia by Frank Zappa, I mean, you can see the mathematical, the thought process going in there. Frank was a much more intelligent man than Jimi Hendrix. But Jimmy had this passion, this soul, this love that goes into it. And what blows my mind is the motherfucker died at 27. 27 years old, and he created that much good music in what, 4 or 5 year range? I mean, it's just absolutely mind blowing. When I think about Kurt Cobain, I've lived longer than Kurt. We've all lived. I don't know how old you are, Anne.
I don't know.
Oh, you know.
No, I know who Kurt Cobain is.
No, how old are you?
Oh, how old am I? 22.
22. Okay, so not. But Janis Joplin though died before us.
Yeah.
Right, like musicians. Now we're slightly forgotten by people who don't pay him enough attention. Buddy Guy being one of them, who Jimi Hendrix took a lot of his ideas from.
Would you rather live fast and die young, or just live out a slow life?
I'm living fast, and I'm still going to live for pretty long because I'm doing it intelligently. You know, I have a lot of stories I could tell you about shit that times have gotten pulled over, ridiculous things I've done, having an 8-year-old pull a gun on me. I mean, you know, all these different things about times I was close to death. I'm just doing it intelligently. You know, now, you know, it's a little bit more.
What have you changed up? How are you going intelligently? What have you changed from your previous life?
Well, one, I don't drink and drive, which is, to me, that's a quick way to improve your lifestyle. I'm jumping off a lot less cliffs into rivers. And economically, I'm being a little bit more intelligent, not thinking that I can live my life just based off of activism, thinking things throughout a bit more, and not making as many mistakes in relationships with people that I have, you know, love relationships or anything else. You know, thinking things throughout a bit more, looking for more virtuous people and not just people that are there because I'm alone. And that's a big reason why we make a lot of mistakes, is that we decide to spend time with people purely out of a fear of being alone. So if you get out of that, you can live probably more peaceful and a more meaningful life.
Newbie 66 says, way to dodge the question, Carlos.
No, because it was and or particular question. I decided not to answer either. So who is he again?
Something.
I think I actually think Newbie 66 lives in the Shire. It's my guess. He's in all the chats.
Well, you can go fuck himself. Anyway, next question.
I find it really hard. I feel like when you join the Liberty Movement, it's almost just like as outcasted as anything weird, like saying you're gay or saying you're like.
But and I will state though, by the way, the risk of coming out as a whistleblower under the Obama administration is probably reckless.
Yeah, that's a little reckless. They're known for putting people in cages for being whistleblowers. Yeah.
No, it is a little reckless. I mean, I'm just trying not to die right now, but it's like the amount of risks I take, according to my mom, I'm asking to die.
Just don't die quiet.
Fuck no. I got too much content out there. Yeah. That's the importance of writing a book, though, because, you know, whenever YouTube videos get pulled down, Podomatic gets pulled down, you still have some text left, and that's kind of nice thing to have.
How is the book doing?
It's doing all right. I mean, it's not where it was when it first started, but I mean, that's always the case, right? Like, shit ton of people buy it. It's doing okay, though. I mean, I make enough a month to pay for my car and car insurance and stuff, which is just kind of a nice side thing to be able to pay for. But what I noticed, though, is that people are picking up the book now. It's more impactful for them, like the messages I get and stuff like that. Like, hey, this got my, you saved my kid or whatever. You know, like those kind of messages. Like I'm saying, whatever.
You're just having to save a bunch of people's children from the state, huh? Whatever.
I wish you could. I talked
shit about Molyneux on a forum, and some guy goes, "What do you do for liberty?"
That's the famous question.
And I wanted to throw everything at him, but I didn't say shit. I was like, "Oh, you faggot! You don't know what the hell you're talking about. Just get the hell out of here. Go choke on a thousand dicks."
A thousand
dicks. All of the dicks. So your head explodes with cocks. Any other questions?
Let's see here. We're actually coming back in like a minute or so.
Is my shit off? Wait, is my microphone's on there, right?
What?
Oh, I'm on mute.
I'm not mute. I just added the feed down low.
Got anything else? In how many seconds?
We got about 30 seconds.
Oh, I could not pull it off. I thought I was going to be able to pull that shit off. Sorry, Eric Johnson. I cannot pull off Cliffs Over Dover. Been too long.
Of today's Week in Review. You will be missed. For more, visit theonion.com/newsbeat.
This is the Onion News Network.
And back to the Rebel. Before we left, we're talking about Erwin Schiff's death in prison for not paying a tax that he didn't owe someone that named the state. And, you know, I think one way to honor any activist's death is to keep doing activism. Not even if it's not necessarily not paying taxes, and seeing where that leads, but, you know, make sure that he's remembered and what, you know, his cause is still shared, because it shouldn't, his, what he was fighting for shouldn't die with him.
Well, he's like the equivalent, I mean, he's sort of like the equivalent of standing in Tiananmen Square in front of the tank. Like, he knows that they're going to come after him. Like, after the first time you go to jail for something, you know, like, that's going to happen. It's going to keep coming for thing over and over again. Yeah, he still did it. Like, he knew that tank was coming. He knew that the state would put him in prison for the rest of his life over just not paying them.
Yeah.
And
I mean,
yet he still did it anyways.
I'd like to see some civil dis. I'd like to see some, you know, protesting in the square, like outside. I'd like to see some stuff happening.
Unfortunately, I don't see society there yet. Like, society isn't there to, like, that.
I feel like the New York Times article about him wasn't very biased. Like, the front page of it says, why pay income taxes when no laws say you have to? And, you know, that's on the front. And when you first read that, you know, that makes you think.
Wow, and did New York Times release that?
Yeah, they, talked about it.
Yeah. I know.
And they talked about it in a non-negative way. So I think that is a step. I think people are, you know, can relate with the fact, yeah, they're stealing money from me. Who in the world is like, yes, let's pay taxes. Like, I love that the government takes half my check.
They actually went.
No one's in.
New York Times actually went into pretty good detail about his position. It's a balanced article. It's written by Dennis Havesi.
Powerful Dennis Havesi. I was like double thinking that name right there.
Yeah, but he goes into, they go into detail about his positions. Like, they talk, they quote him multiple times, but, like, they got his positions great. Especially at one point, they go talk about how his second basic argument was that since all information in a tax return be used against the taxpayers in a criminal proceeding filing out a return, he called it a tax confession that violated the Fifth Amendment's protection against self-incrimination. Like, they're literally listing, like, his main points.
They're stating it like, you know, logic. It's not very, it's not a biased article. And I always look at that when I'm looking for articles about people. Like, are they biased? Like, because that's really trying to tell you, you know, what they're trying to tell society.
Well, and the truth of the matter is that the media is completely statist, and it's incredibly liberal, like the New York Times.
Yeah.
I mean, there's a lie that's in any way conservative. I mean, it's always pro-war if you want to think of conservatism as that is concerned, but it's progressive, right? And that's the New York Times really is.
Yeah, but it's just it's fascinating to see them actually being able to show that.
Or it's possible that they're giving us a little bit of breadcrumbs, so we jump in and then we eat the rest of their shit right afterwards, because everyone's gonna fucking forget this article by tomorrow, and everyone's gonna forget Ian, and then Peter's still gonna be sad. And it's a rough take in, right? It's like trying to figure out, you know, we have to be positive and go, yeah, this is, you know, they did a good article, but fucking he's dead.
Yeah, he's dead
because of the state.
Yeah. How do we keep this? How do we keep his memory alive? Like, can you think of anything that you would like to see people doing activism wise?
So I'm not someone who does the civil dis in the normal sense.
Spill red blood all over yourself and go to the square.
That's not civil disobedience. That's protesting. It's different things. I didn't do anything else.
Oh, okay. Well.
No, I do my own things, right? I mean, but you know, we. Our actions and our way of doing activism. And I know when I was younger, I would certainly judge people for certain things and say, well, that might be dangerous or that might be a non-intelligent thing to do. But the older I've gotten, the more I realized I don't know. I mean, we have 10,000 years of statehood and agriculture that has led to the state that we have right now, which is one of the most monolithic in history. So it's hard to say exactly which thing you should or should not do.
I'd like to see more street theater.
Performance is, and so any kind of performance art, I'm always going to back. And I think you got to switch things up. I mean, I know that the Robin Hooding thing is a thing. I don't know how much more benefit it's going to have now, though. You know, I think you should kind of try to switch things up to get more attention and be able to get that rallying cry. When I was in college, I think I've talked about this on the show before, you know, I did a lot of atheist activism, and a lot of the things we did was really to rile shit up.
Yeah, one of the things that you did when you said you're an atheist activist was the whole porno collection.
What?
So
that was hilarious.
Yeah, fuck it. Well, we'll run down it real quick, just so there's clarification. I did something called Smut for Smut, where people turned in Holy Scripture in for pornography. And it was to demonstrate the fact that pornography was in no way worse for women than any Holy Scripture that we could possibly find as far as being misogynistic or any of those other issues. And so it was a pro-porn thing, but it was also a bigger draw, right? So you get hundreds of people protesting, you know, Fox News calling us up, Huffington Post writing articles about us and everything else. And then, you know, some weak, progressive, liberal atheist going, oh, just change anyone's mind. Fucking keyboard warrior. In their entire life, or certainly never any of their minds, judge people. Right? That's because the easiest thing you can do is shit talk.
Yeah.
That's
yeah,
it.
Yeah, yeah.
That's what most people do whenever they sit around in conversation, especially on the radio. Is a lot of the times what we do is we spend time shit talking because it's one of the easiest ways to communicate without empty air. Because if you actually have to bring up positive things, you can be judged for that. But if you just crap on things, that's much easier. So we can sit down here and say, this type of civil disobedience is bad. This form of protesting is bad. I mean, we could look at the merits based off of history of specific things. But for the most part, throughout history, very few people have been arguing for the complete abolition of the state for a voluntary society afterwards.
I feel like people at this level, rabbit hole of the liberty movement or anarchists and voluntarists and all that jazz, we all. The modern day abolitionist movement. We're the ones advocating for pure freedom from our slave owners, you know, the people that own us, that declare that they own us, and will, in case of Erwin Schiff, they prove that, you know, yeah, you're our slave. You're not obeying what we're telling you to do, so we're going to put you in a cage where you belong. That is the current state of affairs that we live in, and we're the only ones really advocating pure freedom, because everyone else isn't. They're advocating that someone else, you know, they're begging their masters to do something for them instead of actually doing it themselves.
It's dangerous to think differently. Rob, there was a statement issued, correct?
Yeah. Did you see the Department of Justice releasing they're creating a position in favor of basically saying that ISIS is no longer the biggest threat U.S. anti-government groups are.
Yep.
What's your thoughts on that?
Okay, well, you
can
know.
Can you read a little bit for the audience who may be ignorant?
Go for it, boss.
So basically, they're in the article, they're basically comparing hate groups and racist groups and all that jazz with anti-government views, where they're considering us as domestic terrorists and they're actually creating a council to go after domestic terrorist groups.
I think it's the best quote in there was followed by a number of violent acts and plots against the U.S. They are saying they're motivated by anti-government views, racism, bigotry, and anarchy, and other despicable beliefs.
As if anarchy is a bad thing.
That was just the
case. Well, is anyone surprised?
No. Yeah. It's not a surprise at all.
Let's be honest here. There was one more thing, though, and it relates to kind of what we were talking about earlier, the Democratic debate. There's a point that was brought up that's incredibly important because this is how they're going to come after your guns, and they're going to do it passively in a specific way. They stated we need to hold gun makers, gun producers, responsible for mass shootings. What do you think is the quickest way to get gun manufacturers to stop producing weapons and selling weapons?
Assume out of existence.
So there was actually a lawsuit recently where someone actually lost because they sold weapons to someone who went and killed someone, and then he was held responsible for that action. This is the passive way to remove guns from our society so the state can take over.
The state hates competition, especially in self-defense. Tomorrow we get back with Carlos Morales.
Gilbrecht was convicted in early 2015 of the infamous Silk Road.
Webkeys wants to call in because he wanted to ask you a question, Carlos.
Who?
Webkeys. He said, well, question for Carlos. Oh, no. Newbie 66. Question for Carlos. Does getting older make you realize most old people are not wise or smart, and most politicians are just old farts trying to feel relevant by dominating others? I don't know what the actual question was. But that was his question for you. So if you have an answer.
For right now? Oh, okay. So the question of whether the older I get, the less I know, I think the less judgmental necessarily I get on specific actions, like moralistic judgments, like what is the right type of relationship? What is the best way to live your life? As far as the critical analysis of specific things, like whether that be ethics or something, right? That's actually become more solid for me. So I know there are specific ways of thinking that are toxic, and I'm sure of those. Faith-based thinking, which leads to the state and leads to religion. And if you guys want to get into it at all, the Libertarian Atheist podcast, why we bring up atheism on top of libertarianism and the importance of that when we're discussing it, and thinking about that and thinking about mental liberation, thinking about moving beyond the state and the connections between those, it is interesting, though, the point he brings up about old men, though. Like, do old men know jack shit? When I was 18, I thought old men knew jack shit. And I'm pretty sure now, at my age right now, I still think most people are full of shit.
Yeah.
That's what led to what we have right now, right? I mean, we want to talk about the culture of victimization. Talk about fucking old people keep saying, they're trying to take a Medicaid social security away, and everyone's awful, and technology's terrible. So go die.
Yeah, their answer is just a steal from me. Like, social security, they pushed that, but we're not going to get social security.
It's a fucking Ponzi scheme.
Yeah. I just assume that's another tax. I'm not going to get any of that fucking money back.
I don't want it. There's times in my life where I probably could have gotten government support or something. Was an activist, probably could have gotten food stamps. I'm not going to do that because I'm not a weak bitch.
Yeah.
Live your fucking life, get a goddamn retirement account,
well, I just don't want them to take my money first to begin with. Like, yeah. You know, I want the money back that they took, yeah. But I don't want, like...
Food stamps is just, like, crack. They just, that's how they get them to keep
coming back. Can you ask him if I didn't answer his question?
Did Carlos answer your question?
Probably not, right?
Newbie 66. The feeling of something important. Please let us know.
Oh, God, is that Ali Havens?
Yeah.
Visit ShireSociety.com to read and sign the Shire Society Declaration and learn the reasons
why... Did I answer his question?
He said hitting your children violates the nap, but how do you feel about it violating your religious freedoms? You can answer that when we come back on it.
I don't fucking care. It's wrong. Is it violating people's religious freedoms by saying that it's wrong to murder people? Because according to
the
Torah, according to especially the Quran, you should kill people. So fuck any dogma that states to do things against. Oh, that's it. Yeah, Old Testament style. But not why an iota shall change from a old law, according to Jesus. But he was an anarchist. Yeah, right.
Mostly there's just this idea of Bernie Sanders. Kickstart asked a question.
What did he ask? Oh, that's funny. I'm not gonna see it on there.
What did he say? Talk shit?
Yeah. He wants to know the story.
What story?
Your response to. Welcome back to the Rebel Love Show, and we got Carlos here in the studio. We were talking about a bunch of different things, but I kind of want to go into how atheism leads to liberty, because that seems like that's your two your pillars.
Yeah,
you know, like what? Why atheism? Why use that to like bring over more people into the world of liberty?
Wait. First, Carlos Morales versus Will Coley celebrity death match.
Who's Will Coley?
Oh, he's that. He's a
He's the Islam guy?
Yeah, he's a Muslims for Liberty guy.
Yeah, sure.
It's a libertarian.
But not a death match. I mean, unless he wants to go by his religion and actually kill me, but I'll shoot him.
Okay, so back to atheism.
There's your fucking answer. Now, back to the atheism.
But yeah, how does atheism really lead to for you?
How do we develop the state? The state doesn't really exist, right? It's a culture. It's a figment of our imagination. It's an idea based primarily acting not within accordance of critical thinking, not within accordance of logic, grammar, rhetoric, right? It's out of a lack of knowing and acting in spite of or in contradiction to evidence. Well, what definition fits? What word fits believing in something in contradiction to evidence? It's faith. It's faith-based thinking that leads to the state. So when you listen to a lot of podcasts or other people talking about the state, whenever they don't know the answer to a specific question, how do we deal with the social stigma? How do we deal with the social issue? Well, the government can handle it. When you ask someone a question regarding epistemology or the nature of reality or the beginning of the universe or evolution, they go, well, I don't know, therefore God. It's always, I don't know, therefore X. And when it comes to the scientific method and understanding reality, you do not get an answer out of simply saying you're ignorant of it. Right? And so what I find is that the same type of faith-based thinking that leads to the state is the same type of faith-based thinking that leads to believing in religion. And the state itself is merely a figment of imagination that rationalizes coercion and leads to the situation that we have. Where someone dies in prison for not atoning by not giving away specific kinds of money to the state.
One thing that really I never understood is like so many people that go, complete atheist or, don't believe in God, but they still seem to replace religion with the state.
Absolutely.
They use that as their religion.
The entire progressive movement as a whole, which is actually more important to reach out to atheists than libertarians.
Oh, I agree. Bring more liberty to progressives, and you will. I mean, they're already on board.
Yeah, libertarians think they know everything.
Well, and the progressive movement is there's a few parts of that. What I find that one with most secular people who believe in the state, they generally believe that if they're running the state, they'll do it better. I mean, it's just narcissist, right? And the thing is that when you live in a society that is dominantly religious, and you see these people who believe in stupid ideas, you start to lose hope. And your thought is, well, we need to use the government to implement our ideas because people are too stupid, right? That was the progressivist movement in the early 1900s. It was eugenics.
Oh, yeah. Kill off the people that are dumb.
Or sterilize
don't let them. Don't let them breed.
Institutionalize them, throw in a public education so that we can teach them the way. And so that's the question that gets brought up to me is, well, there's 100 million deaths due to atheism. No, there's 100 million deaths due to communists who happen to be quote-unquote atheists, who I don't really Though I'm not going to do thick atheism where I'm going to say that if you vote Democrat, therefore you're not a real atheist. But in a way, you're kind of not, because you're replacing one religion with another one without individual sovereignty, which is why I think atheism without the philosophy behind it is worthless, because you don't really have a reason to live life or the ways to be able to deal with it. You need the ethics behind it, which is why I like the argumentation ethics brought to you by, you know, Hans Hermann Hoppe and Stefan Kinsella, where he explains a secular way about approaching ethics.
I think that's really interesting to hear both sides of it, because I in college was like, oh, I'm atheist, and then they're just like this dark, depressive person. It's because they have no happiness and no reason to really live. And I think I never really correlated it with.
Well, I don't know. I would make something strong about not a reason to live. I mean, necessarily, right? I mean, they'll figure out something. Maybe get laid or have fun or drink or something.
Which honestly, people get so stuck in.
It's true, but Christians do the exact same thing, which is why I think a lot of Christians are atheists and know it. I mean, honestly, if you believe in religion, you will burn it. If you have sex outside of wedlock, yet so many Christians do. I'm thinking. I don't even think they actually believe in God. Like they're
making themselves as uncomfortable as possible. Yeah. I just felt like that's what it was like to be a Christian.
Well, and it's kind of like the saying, atheist and foxhole. And the truth of the matter, atheist and foxhole. Because if you truly believed in God, you wouldn't need to be in foxhole. You'd run out there naked and just start shooting out like nowhere, because God's going to help you shoot that bullet.
I kind of find that probably the bigger battle is not so much to get people off of Christianity to become an atheist. I think it's probably a bigger battle of get atheists to stop supporting statism.
I don't know.
You know,
I think my numbers are pretty similar as far as being able to kind of change people's minds on both things, because they hold them passionately because, one, they never really hold to actual critical thinking. They were raised in abusive situations in their life, and they weren't introduced to these. They were introduced instead to public education. I mean, it's unfortunate, but, you know, the question of, you know, libertarians who are also Christians, and I get brought up, why do you think that's bad? Well, I think for the same reason I was discussing. I think we need to move to a place where we're moving all dogmas from our lives. Because if it's the epistemology matters just as much as the answer. It's not just the answer, it's how you got to it. If you're going to say it's Jesus that brought me to liberty, well, someone can convince you tomorrow that Jesus says communism instead, because you're using an argument from authority rather than using a critical method to develop why this is the correct way. It's that faith-based thinking, which I truly think is the ultimate enemy to all of this.
I just always looked at it as the people looking for people to take care of your problems so that you don't really have to do anything. And that's why I just never turned on to religion and was forced to go to church and be baptized and Sunday school and Bible study. And everyone just seemed so phony all the time. Like, I could never.
I lucked out. I had like 3 weeks of church, and that was it. My family was like, ah, that's boring.
I went out of my way for it. I mean, I fucking leave. You know, and honestly, every belief that I've ever had, I've been fucking pretty passionate about it, if you can't tell from my personality right now. You know, I truly saw the people around me. I didn't think they really believed in God, because they were not trying to find every single person who is not religious and try to convert them, because I desperately not the person. Like, out of a sense of empathy, I don't want you to burn. And I've been told that you're going to burn in hell if you don't believe. And the more and more I started questioning, the more and more hardcore it became about my belief. Because it was, oh God, I'm having these negative thoughts. Well, according to the Bible, the only unforgivable sin is to deny the Holy Spirit. Well, if I deny the Holy Spirit, that's worse than raping. That's worse than fucking kids. That is worse than murder. It is worse than everything else.
Yeah.
The ultimate unforgivable sin is critical thinking.
And you can't.
That should tell you a lot about a fucking religion they're going to justify and says brings you to liberty.
What back home? Because I just, like, I don't talk to anyone back home. Because
I'm great. I left it with my friends became atheist anarchists by the time I left. So
Everyone was good just like, I'll pray for you. And I'm just like, I can't. Don't pray for me, people.
Invention is coming up fast. That's the beauty of learning scales. You just hear something and like,
oh, I'm digging you like trying to play along, add the bumpers, man. I'm digging.
I'm gonna go for complicated next. play some music. What time is it right now?
It is 11:30. So we got two segments left.
All right, I'm going to play next then.
Okay.
So someone said, is religion merely a substitute for absent fathers?
I couldn't say that. For religion, I couldn't quite say that because you've had the nuclear family with Christianity for a long period of time. I think it's an absence of critical thinking, though, and a sense of true autonomy and sovereignty, respect for the individual self, and respect for the fact that we as human beings can educate ourselves without the use of an authority. And what faith causes is you have to not critically think. And because we cannot educate ourselves, so we cannot find the truth ourselves, it always leads to authority-based thinking.
So let's see if I can... It's an effort to move 20,000 people. This is going to be a fucking complicated one. I'm totally going to try and pull off because, you know, fun. It's the world's largest libertarian community.
All right. Any other questions? Or did I answer that guy's question?
Close enough. Are you going to do Creepertarian? Come on. You know, you played that like right as we're coming down from our mushroom trip. Like, it was beautiful. I got to download it and throw it in as a video file.
Think of that personal gift.
Oh, it was. It was beautiful.
Think of it that way.
Absolutely. You came in like exactly at the right time.
That was for y'all. It wasn't for a bunch of people who were not there.
You had to be there.
Yeah, go to Porkfest, guys. If you haven't been there yet, do it as a religious pilgrimage.
Webkeez wants me to tell you that he wants to jazz jam with you sometime soon.
Who's that?
Webkeez.
World Peace?
Webkeez.
Who's Webkeez?
He has... But anyway, I want to do a jazz jam with you sometime.
All right, send me a message on Facebook. I never played in the metal band.
I like the fact that he's calm and relaxed.
Who's calm and relaxed?
Stonewall. Tell your side of the story, use specifics, and detail what correct. Like, he's the most calm puppy I've ever seen.
Would you mind if I left your amp here till tomorrow?
Oh, yeah, that's fine.
I just,
yeah,
no, I'm not going to want to fucking carry that
cunt right now. You can leave it here. You can pick it up the next day. Cool. That's not a problem.
I'm just like, fuck, this thing sucks lifting.
Shows.lrn.fm.
And welcome back, Rebel Love. I forget what we're talking about, but it was intense. So, is Carlos going to play another
song? Yeah, he is going to bring us in with another song.
Serenade us, Carlos. Take it away.
I want to smoke a whole bowl for this one.
Thank you.
Once again, kill that shit, Carlos.
God damn.
And I'm not just saying because I'm high.
No.
No.
Thoroughly enjoy when you play.
So, one of my favorite podcasts out there is Star Talk. I love Neil deGrasse Tyson. But he's so logical when it comes to science. Status. I know. And it pisses me off so fucking much that he's a statist.
Because the state pays his bills.
Oh, yeah. He wouldn't be
No, it was one of the greatest ideas ever to have the state appear to be a philanthropic institution. And that there's a religion based around this. It was a great idea for the state and progressives to fund the most intelligent group for their fucking hobbies. The Hadron Collider is a hobby that they've spent billions of dollars on. And any single time you question that idea, they get really mad because you're fucking with their hobbies. Do you know what the free market gets us? This.
Yeah.
Phones. Technology. Beautiful things that we've been able to get. Now, occasionally, the state will come out with some cool. Like, I mean, DARPA, you know, parts of DARPA led to the internet as we have it. But people don't think about the unseen costs. All they see is what's there. They don't see... Well, yeah, we got the internet, but I mean, you know, all this other blood and everything else happened. Maybe the internet could even be better if it wasn't developed in part by the way the state decided to outline it. But if you bring that up, they go, oh, well, that's just wishful thinking. And so it's great that all the leading intellectuals are paid for by the state because it sets it up so that any single time anyone questions it, they can simply state, well, this other smart guy believes in it. Therefore, you're not as smart as him, are you?
There was a little bit that he's given me a little hope. Because he had Edward Snowden on his show and interviewed him. You know, he's interviewing someone that's the enemy of the state. Someone who's literally in hiding with the enemy of our, you know, Russians are the enemy, blah, blah, blah. But, like, they're talking about how, like, he's, you know, he's treating him as if, like, he's a hero standing up against
that's
the state.
That's beautiful that he's willing to do that. But, of course, the answer isn't in the state. The answer is, let's recalibrate the state for the benefit of intellectuals.
Put another Band-Aid on the stab wound.
Yeah, he one other thing with him, like he talks about, he always wants more funding, everything. Like you said, he is paid for by the state. You know, his job, his everything he's done, almost all science is really by the state.
Especially people that smart. Like, I feel like the questions just come naturally. Like, why does this person get to be my owner?
Yeah, like why is it so much that scientists and other prominent figures, you know, they don't get to this level philosophically?
I just feel like it's not hard to get to.
Because they want a model of a state in reality, right? Like, they want it so that the super intellectual are allowed to run the lives of others because everyone is too stupid. While it's still not also acknowledging the fact that it was the state who educated those people. And if you go, well, the people are stupid and they're educated by the state, well, it's because the state needs more money to educate more people because it's being brought up by corporate interests or the church or something else. They'll always figure out ways to move around the question. In the same way in the religious motif, which is essentially every single time you disprove another religious view, it's called God in the gaps. Okay, so, you know, before we knew about how the universe went or how human beings were created, the answer of God was broader and broader. It was really, really big, right? Like, why did we come to be the way we are? God. Well, then it became evolution. Then it was, well, God started up evolution. And then we finally got to the point of the Big Bang, and it was, well, so God is getting smaller and smaller and smaller, but every single time we see a gap, we get added in God. So every single time we see an issue caused by the state, it's always tiny in the gaps. Well, we need the state to take care of that.
Here's a question for you as an atheist. What happens if science can kind of... I don't know if you ever heard of the simulation theory, but what if, you know...
Mathematician jacking off?
Yeah. But what if, like, somehow science or mathematics can actually prove that the universe was created? That there actually is a, you know, that there's a creation to the universe. Isn't that kind of, it's as if, like, science is proving God's existence? Like, what's your take on anything like that? No, I mean,
it certainly doesn't prove Abraham has ever mentioned even the germ theory of disease. So certainly we'll talk about that.
Well, what now, I'm saying, God, I'm saying, like, a higher existence.
Even if it stated that, then who created that? Right? It's the infinite turtles on another turtle shell. You know, the earth is flat as upon a turtle shell. Well, what is that on top of another turtle shell? And it keeps going down and down and down and down. So if the question is, well, something had to have started everything. Well, if you're going to make that claim, then something had to have started that, and you have infinite regression. So is it possible that everything's a simulation and this is what led to the place we are right now? Maybe.
There's like this cop who was like, poof, let there be light.
Yeah, because the question, my issue with the claim been God to start it all, infinitely more complex than the universe itself. And to assume that a bunch of savages from 2,000 years ago knew the nature of the cosmos without ever bringing up the fact that the world is in a way spherical and that we're turning around the sun is kind of absurd.
Oh, yeah, absolutely. I mean, science is hopefully, it's gotten us great places, but at the same time, they fall for the state.
Kickstart says my take on it is Anne should never be sober.
I love
Anne. Anne is high, and Carlos is cool, so their show is going well tonight.
Here you go. Oh, Nate from Legacy Radio is on.
Who?
Another podcaster. He's not really into Liberty. He's a comedy podcast. He's listening.
Dude, I busted the fucking E string halfway in between that song, which is why I ended it in a weird way. It's like it pulled behind the pickup, and I was like, oh, shit.
It was epic. By the way, like I have like this great visualization going behind you, and the lighting actually worked the whole time, so I didn't even change the shot while you're playing that last one.
Okay,
beautiful.
Dave Painter says to answer his messages. What messages, Dave Painter? Are they sent to my inbox and you're not friends with me? Because then they get shuffled into a background thing because I get about, I don't know, 40 messages a day. Sorry, homie. It's no disrespect to you, but it's really hard to answer everything while also having a job for 12 hours a day.
Say hello. Yeah,
it's hard to get all these fucking messages. Motherfucker, got to make some money. You guys know King of the Hill?
Yeah, yeah. What other covers do you know?
So I can do that. Any Nirvana song ever?
Do you know any Zach Deputy song?
No, because he never plays the same song twice. Yeah, he just says.
My favorite song I ever heard from him is called Just the Tip.
He just made it up there. Well, he has a beautiful voice, which I do not have.
Oh my God.
I can just play the fuck out of some guitar, but I cannot sing.
He's like a one man jam band. He's
not
everything.
Like one.
Yeah,
he is one.
Yeah.
But he, I'm going to buy some equipment after watching him. I need to get some drum stuff.
Because I play Kurt Cobain. Wow. So Newbie66 has photoshopped you onto Kurt Cobain's body.
Oh my God, I gotta see that shit.
I'm back in a few seconds.
Okay.
Details on how to get a free bumper sticker, quarter page flyers you can print out and distribute, banners for your website, as well as files that will allow you to make your own custom banners and graphics. Visit promote.lrn.fm and help bring new listeners to the Liberty Radio Network. That's promote.lrn.fm.
Why are you playing a slot machine sound for an online poker site?
Do you have a poker sound effect? Because we have a new advertiser, swcpoker.eu.
Brought to you by the same guys that did Seals with Clubs.
Now they're called swcpoker.eu. It's Bitcoin Poker 2.0. They have lots of new games, including Chinese poker. The Krill leaderboard is active now. It's Bitcoin Poker from the brand you trust, swcpoker.eu.
Get on over to swcpoker.eu and start playing now.
If you enjoy LRN.FM, please contribute to your favorite shows via their websites and become an amplifier at amp.lrn.fm.
You missed out on Humpfest, and I wish you were there. However, we saw Zach Deputy, absolutely beautiful performance.
So I saw him in Pensacola, Florida, of all fucking places. That man. And the most unfortunate thing is the fact that there's no really good videos of him. Like, I've seen stuff, but none of it hits his fucking performances live.
And you know what's another thing with that? Like, I've gone through, like, listening to, like, his music online, it doesn't even come close to like the experience it is like seeing him live. Like that's not true at all.
It's true of almost all looper musicians though. Like I've tried to record some stuff of things, and a lot of it has to do with just kind of witnessing it all coming together. Because when we're listening to records, we're not quite kind of absorbing what's really going on there.
You know, yeah, I mean, I hear you on that. Now, you kind of hinted at a story that you have hanging out with Zach Deputy, and you give me the dirty eye with that. Like, we don't have to talk about it. You don't want to talk about it.
No. It was more just a matter of just kind of seeing him live and everything else. It was a great thing. And also, by the way, people who looper musicians, a guy named Mad Violinist. He's this gangster guy who plays the fuck out of an electric violin. Like hip-hop beats. He played right before Zach Deputy, and it was amazing. I mean, just remarkable musicians out there. And anyone who's interested in really good guitarists, check out, to me, the greatest guitarist alive right now, a woman named Kaki King. K-A-K-I King. She makes me look like shit. Just crazy performer.
I'll have to check that out. Now, what would you say, music-wise, what is, like, the Liberty scene, the Liberty music world?
Terrible.
Yeah, there's not...
Oh, it's
out
shitty.
There at all.
Sexy, right? Like thinking
garbage.
About the
age.
I love your silence.
Is music.
Are we going to call you out? Should we call you out? No, we won't. What do you want to see in the music in regards to Liberty music? What do you want to see out there?
Nothing.
Nothing.
Right. Don't sing about Liberty.
Well, can you just make an album? That's a better question. When can I get Carlos Morales?
Months, Joe Svets is gonna help me out with it.
I mean, I pay Bitcoin for that. So
no, he's we're working on it. I've already got two different things recorded, so it's gonna be coming out soon. We'll have like six or seven songs. We'll put it all together.
Nice. We'll have.
But honestly, like the question of, for some reason, it's easier to sing about. I mean, the punk rockers have kind of proved that, right? Principles, argumentation, ethics, NEP, versus like burn this motherfucker down. You know, Dead Kennedys, though, had some songs with really good kind of themes, a couple protesting songs where they kind of broke down the stupidity of lighting your own house on fire while you're doing a form of protest. But I just don't know. I there's musicians who are musicians and then they happen to be libertarians. Frank Zappa, the best case, right? Brilliant musician. He never really sung about liberty, but then you'd hear him talk because you respected him and he would have a good libertarian message, which is very, very rare in the music world. If I had to judge musicians based off of their libertarian leanings, I would be done, you know?
Yeah, there's not many out there at all.
No. Like Kaki Kaki, a musician, right? Yeah, she's also like a progressive, crazy, liberal, social justice warrior.
A lot of I wish like artists like or actors I like in different movies and stuff like that, I wish that they weren't they didn't have a political or a philosophical viewpoint.
You just rather them just shut the fuck up. I totally agree.
You know, play your music, be an actor, don't advocate the state in any way, don't say something absolutely ridiculous that's pro-war or anything along those lines. Just, you know, entertain. You know, that's unless, of course, you're a pro-liberty guy, then, of course, like, by all means, do that. Yeah. But, you know.
What about Ron Noyes?
I don't know who that is.
Yeah, he's a really good musician in the New Hampshire scene.
Yeah. I actually liked him, like a lot.
Yeah, I remember so many fucking bad Ron Paul songs during the Ron Paul campaign. Ron Paul, Ron Paul, Ron Paul, Ron Paul, freedom, constitution, ethics. Just awful, awful shit.
Well, and I liked your music. I feel like you definitely...
And people should know, I'm absolutely a judgmental asshole when it comes to music. I'm just honest about it, right? Like, what's very annoying to me is people go, I like all music. It's not true. You probably don't like, you know, some weird Hawaiian music plus Tejano and polka. You know, just get yourself.
You gotta be honest.
Yeah, you gotta be honest. And there's a lot of shitty music out there.
My favorite memory of Porkfest, well, one of them was you playing us off into the night. And, you know, that's a song like that is something that sticks with you. And just runs through your head. So congratulations.
It was one of like for that night that she's talking about. We were going through like this whole mushroom trip through Porkfest. Like it was a Wednesday, so like everything was kind of lit up and everything like that. Beautiful, and it was a whole adventure the entire night. And we come down, and all of a sudden you just start serenading us throughout like our end of the trip.
Fuck on edibles while drinking a bottle of Jack Daniels and singing, "I'm a creepertarian, not a libertarian."
We like just ran into him, and it was perfect. And we skipped off into the darkness, and like I don't even remember what happened after that. But you know those songs that make you that take you back to like a feeling. That song will always be that. So that's awesome.
As weird as that song was,
glad I could give you that experience.
It was an adventure. But thank you for like coming into our journey at the very end and playing it off. It was like the best ending to that that mushroom trip that I could have ever thought of. So it was beautiful.
David,
how many more minutes we got?
I'm sorry, David. Dave Painter says answer his messages. He wanted me to tell you that. So I don't know who Dave Painter is, but if you got a message from him, Carlos.
Oh, and also, someone in the chat here, when we brought up Liberty Music, and I kind of want your response to this, they go, Lauren Rumpler has good music in the chat. That is from
Lauren Rumpler?
Nate from Legacy Radio. Nate, you are either you're an absolute fool or you're trolling.
What kind of question is that?
I know.
You know who's actually a really good like vocalist? Renee. She should sing more. She actually has a really pretty voice.
I really haven't had much chance to listen to her sing at all.
She's actually really, really good.
I can't sing more shit at all. I don't know about you, Carlos. Are you a good singer at all?
Yeah, I can sing. I sung for punk bands, but to call myself a good singer is not true. I can yell out lyrics in tone. That's very, very different than singing.
Yeah. I mean, punk rock is more just... No. What's some of your favorite punk bands growing up?
Bad Religion was my number one punk band.
I should put that two and two together right there with that one. No, I was a Social D fan. I like Social Distortion and the Clash a little bit.
I liked the Clash and NoFX. But you know, when I was younger, I got into all these different types of music that none of my friends seemed to be into. I was like really into B.B. King when I was 10.
Oh,
it was very specific.
That's awesome. Yeah,
it was B.B. King, Stevie Ray Vaughan, and Jimi Hendrix. Those are the three guys I would listen to on a compulsion. Just wanting to be able to play like them.
Can I confess? I really, really, really like country music.
Oh,
like
that's quite a confession.
Yeah, it's
like
it's really coming out as a meth addict to me.
I walked into the honky tonk just the other day. Yeah, I dropped a quarter in the jukebox.
The struggle is real here sometimes.
The struggle is fucking real.
Yeah,
Jesus
like
Christ.
Thankfully,
I usually take over the DJing when we're together because.
He doesn't let me play. He suppresses my musical.
Well, some of your musical tastes are great, babe. But like when the country songs start playing out of Pandora,
country, not even a little.
Johnny Cash, that's about it. And I mean, and then I like Tex-Mex blues, you know, Stevie Ray Vaughan type stuff, where you get that nice. Let's see.
I like that. It's simple, but you can feel it. You can feel like every like pulse with the beat. And that's what I like about country music. And I feel like I can't get that with any other kind of music, really. So judge me if you want.
No, I'm judging, babe. That's one of the few things I will judge. Yeah. So Carl,
that was a silly statement of the night.
I know.
I like
you're
it.
Too bad.
No. Not that country music, but it's that other music can't give you that. No. Like folk, bluegrass.
No, yeah, but country does it the best.
I know. Subjective value theory.
So, Carl,
your subjective values are wrong. Anyway.
Where can people find you at?
Okay, you can find my book at legallykidnapped.net. You can find my podcast at libertarian-atheist.com. And if I like you, you can add me on Facebook.
All right. And you can find all of our content at rebellovshow.com. Peace, guys.
Peace.